welcome challenge? Because there's the often no more things to do. I've noticed we get quite a bit, yeah. Okay, Councillor Ken.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, to echo Councillor Simon, saying that the reason we should be wanting to change this council isn't because of the government, isn't because of Mike Cunningham and his team, it's because we believe this council isn't dealing with the needs of the people of Liverpool as effectively and as efficiently as you should be. And in that context, I've made it clear to the commissioners that I don't think commissioners are the best form of external intervention. It's quite clear to me that external intervention is required from some people outside holding a mirror to what we're doing. And that's why sometimes having interims in, such as our interim head of internal audit, can be useful, because you were telling me before the number of councils you've been in, similar I'm sure with the other interims, you bring another experience to challenge the way we've always done things. Now, I'd particularly like to ask Chief Commissioner if he'd just expand a bit more on the whole question of scrutiny, which came out very clearly in the best value inspection, and we are going to be dealing with next week. Until very recently, there's been a feeling inside the council that we've been doing good scrutiny. But that was fairly, as an opinion, was fairly demolished by Max Keller. So I'd be interested to get your feelings about where scrutiny has been. Have some of the problems arisen because we haven't scrutinised properly? Because the difference between them shouldn't be the controlling party and the opposition parties, but those who make decisions and those who effectively scrutinise them. And I know you've signed off the two reports to go to council next week, but are you satisfied with the progress on the changes, things like the instruction KPI? So where have you been, where are we, and are we getting in the right place on scrutiny?
Improvements are being made. The issue on scrutiny is that the people scrutinising can only do so on the basis of the information that they're presented with. And I think there is a concession, a recognition that sometimes that information has not been sufficiently well presented, options have not been sufficiently well presented, and reports, well, we've commented on
the speed of the football that Sue Cameron in to make sure that they get the right position.
Chairman, whether I could ask, I know that question is directed at me, but I think it would be fair to see if the monitoring officer say something about this, because I'm conscious that the responsibility for the flow of reports sits with officers, and before I said anything, it would be good to hear where Dan has been with this and the work he's doing to promote improvements.
I think that's
referred
to as asking in the past. No, I mean, it will vary with individual reports, so I'm quite happy to discuss an individual report with you, but what we're trying to do is get a better and more consistent rhythm in terms of the report preparation. And what we've had is that when I arrived, there was very little process. So our real risk was that things were, shall we say, rushing to Gavin, rather than having full and considered views from cabinet members, from legal, financial, equalities perspectives, to ensure the report and the recommendations put forward were the right recommendations that met the council's priorities and that underlying issue about delivering value for money. And we've still got challenges, I would accept that, and we're rolling out a series of report writing training sessions. We've got 89 people signed up, and that will help improve the quality there and the consistency, which I think is just as important, to make sure the right things are in there and consistently, so we don't get varying qualities of reports. I think I would say it's an ongoing journey. I've been a monitoring officer since 2008, and I would say this is a constant issue in every authority I work with, is getting that consistency in the quality, because ultimately the decisions cabinet makes and the basis on which they make are the most important decisions that an authority will make with significant financial implications. And we've been discussing reports where that hasn't happened in the past. We need to make that right. So we've got a process in place. We're constantly reviewing that process, and we're making changes this month because of feedback from commissioners about them having adequate time to look at things, to have their comments, and that's the right way to go about things. We're training officers, and what we're also, and it may be an explanation for the report you're referring to, what we're not allowing is reports to go forward when they're not good enough. But I can clearly you don't believe that in this particular case.
This is a report that was signed off by the commissioners, signed off by the cabinet, and yet it missed the deadline for some reason. So I was just trying to get an explanation.
Yeah, I'm quite happy. Let's pick it up outside the meeting at that particular one, because there may be another explanation.
Councillor Gregory, Stephen Gregory, you would be a great councillor.
There's a scandal. I think everyone would be aware of the model that's called the Three Lines of Defence model for risk governance. And it was basically saying that the third line of defence is internal audit, which makes them a very easy target if things go wrong, when actually we should be looking at the first and the second line of defence at the same time. Which is
when we look at risk management, it's a great assurance framework. I want to not talk in a risk buffing type way. So first line is your day-to-day management stuff. Your second line is your oversight, and your third line is me and my lot and external audit and other assurance providers as well. If we can get that model working for you really well, the audit plan drops out of that because we've already identified the key risks. So what are the key risks of the council? We don't need to be geniuses to work those out, and then we map those three lines against it. So absolutely, that's the plan in terms of future assurance mapping, and that gets us sort of into best practice territory there. But the fact that someone on the audit committee is wearing three lines is a great thing for me, because it means that we can implement that one quite easily, I think. For those councillors who are not yet familiar with it, it will change your life. I'm not that
I was thinking of calling myself.
Okay, thank you. A fun point for me, I guess it's more of an action really, it's probably not something to add as part of the action track. I think there are some clear directions in there in the report that I think this committee can pick up. And a lot, the big one for me is actually the lesson learned. We've already done some exercises, but I think that the ones identified that haven't been picked up certainly need to be a part of our work programme going forward. So in terms of the action tracker, I think that seems to be something that can be added as part of the minutes, if that's okay. And I can refer to the self-minutes, the ones that need to go in. Does anyone else have any other comments?
Sorry, Chair. Work, specifically, obviously that then links to finance overall. How does
7 then, grant forms and audit plan year ending 31st March 2022. Can members turn to pages 116 to 147 of the agenda? And can I welcome Sarah Ironmonger and Ali Wilcox for grant forms?